I don't know how many of you enjoyed doing this, but when I was young, I really enjoyed listening to the adult men in the church talk. I liked it when my dad was there and he was talking to, you know, to whoever, and just, you know, talking things of the Lord, talking things maybe even in general, but even more so when they were talking about the things of the Lord. It was great to be able to see some of those men, because my dad was involved in so many of their lives, how they grew. I'm not going to say any names over the internet right now, but just there are names that come to mind that got saved, and the Lord did a great work in them, and just how they changed. It was just a joy. Came in here earlier, tonight, about hour and a half ago, and there was somebody from the there were two people from the Spanish ministry up in the balcony. I didn't know exactly, you know, what was going on, but praise God, one of the men was leading another man to Christ. His life has changed now. You know, you never, at least let's put it this way, that we should never get over that. And it's just a joy to hear people grow. Went and got some food. We got some Subway sandwiches when the missionary was here after the service. By the way, one of the pictures that he showed in the video that was there, when there were all these young men gathered around him, he was teaching, he was preaching in the public school. The missionary that he's going to be working with, they're there every Thursday in the public school there preaching the Word of God. How'd you like to have that kind of freedom? But anyway, you know, let me back up a little bit on this. When I read Peter, I think of, you know, situations that have taken place where somebody, I mean, their life has changed. When you think of Peter, what do you think of? Come on. When you think of Peter, all right, Apostle Peter, what do you think? Think of the rock? What? Denial? What? Who? Uh-huh, yes. Now, you think about the rock, what? Walked on the water. And like John Getch preached, you know, it's not the size of the faith, it's the endurance of faith, because all of a sudden his faith, you know, went, and when the faith went, he went in the water, you know. But we wind up thinking about those times when he really stepped out and thud, or, you know, when he denied Christ. Sometimes we think of when he was, you know, spoke of the rock, and we'll be thinking about that a little bit tonight. Yes, yeah. But here's the thing that's great, Ed. When we get to thinking about that, what we need to do is stop and go, wait a minute, I want to hear him. He's telling us, and I was thinking, it's almost like it's conversational tone. He's telling us, you know, look, this is who you are, and this is what you do. And it's all based around Christ. Now, you know, in all seriousness, that's what we need to do. We need to see the Lord in everything. It's a joy. We were talking a little bit earlier. You know, what do you do when you wake up? Man, I'm, you know, praying and thanking the Lord and rejoicing. That's because of Christ. I want to get that down. I just don't want to have it, you know, Sunday night, 6:30 in the pulpit. I want a Thursday night at 4, or Thursday morning at 4 o'clock in the morning, when I'm praying for something that's heavy on my heart. So we're kind of catching Peter in mid-thought here, because we're chopping it up. We have to do that. But we're catching him instructing us, but what he has done, he's built this instruction around who Christ is and three quotes from the Old Testament. As he starts this out, who we are and what we do, he is speaking of Christ. So what we do, instead of starting at verse 5, let's go to verse 6. Look at this. Wherefore, also it is contained in the Scripture, and he quotes Isaiah 28:16. Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Now the word elect, a chosen, out one, precious, held in high honor. He says, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious. Who is that? Christ. And he that believeth on him shall not be confounded, shall not be put to shame. Because we stand firm, like we talked about this morning. We're standing on the solid rock. Believers trust in Christ, much as a building rests on a cornerstone. I remember when we were in Israel, it pointed out cornerstone. A cornerstone is the visible support on which the rest of the building relies for strength and stability. So Peter encouraged readers in this. You build on Christ. You don't build on a firm financial status, because money can disappear. But you base it on the solid rock of Christ. You base your life there. You will not be confounded. You'll not be put to shame. It's, in other words, you won't. I put my trust in the wrong thing. Oh my! What? How could I do that? Now, with that in mind, he says this now in verse 7, unto you. So he is addressed, speaking of Christ. He has addressed that, and now he says, unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious. But unto them which be disobedient, and now he goes into quoting Psalm 118:22, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner. What Peter is doing here, he's showing a contrast. I don't want to get into this big time, but I thought this was interesting. There are certain people that, quote unquote, protest in places like capitals and such. You can look at one particular group, and when they leave, everything's clean. Everything's clean. When another group leaves, there is trash and filth everywhere. You know something? There's a difference. There's a difference in how people see themselves, how people see their families, how people see their country, how people see their job. Some people, they're loving it. They're there to be a benefit, no matter what it is. But then there are other people, it's almost like they're toxic no matter what they touch, because of an attitude, not because of something that you can't do anything about. We're talking about an attitude. By the way, that's a good thing. You know, make sure you're building other people up. Amen? You know, this is what we're supposed to be doing. We don't cut other people down, cut brethren down. My soul, like the missionary, the Facendas, you know, for the last several months, Satan has been attacking their church. Satan attacks this church. He attacks you, and you know that, don't you? The last thing you need is to come into your local fellowship and get attacked. Let's not do that. So, he says, I'm showing you in contrast something. To the believer, Jesus Christ is held in high honor. Oh, I was starting to tell this. Speaking of this, I was going into this. We had the missionaries here, and we gave them sandwiches. So I had to go over to Subway and pick some up. You know, it's kind of interesting. You get around people, and I remember this from construction and such, and some of you might, you know, you might have neighbors or people that you work with and stuff, but the filth just flows from the mouth, the four-letter words. It's like the same thing recently coming over the airwaves because of, again, you know, a protest. But it's just really, really sad. And one of the names they love to use is the name of your Savior and mine. Why? Because of their master. And that's sad, because Christ did so much for them. To the believer, he's held in high honor. You're not going to use his name like that. But to the unbeliever, the disobedient, he has been disallowed. The word disallowed here, putting something or someone to the test and coming to the conclusion that they failed the test. Let me ask you, where has Christ failed the test? Don't you love it? You can look back and realize, Lord, you have saved me from myself. I mean, I look back and it's like, if it wasn't for the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm toast. I'm toast. I mean, I don't know where I would be. I can stop and think about some things. It's just really sad. But I do know this, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't be in church, period, if it wasn't for Christ. God has taken Jesus Christ and made him the chief cornerstone of our lives. Think about it. The God of heaven became man. He became flesh and blood, came to earth, was failed. They said, you failed as Messiah. We have disallowed you. What did he do? He didn't feed their flesh. He didn't feed their pride. Instead, he died for their sin. He was not the Messiah that they were looking for. You know, and that makes us stop and think, what is it that we look for? When we think of Jesus Christ, what are we looking for? We don't have a candy machine Christ. You know, put in $3 worth of prayer and out comes the candy out, you know, anything you want. That's not what the Lord wants. He wants to bring our will into his will so that we pray according to his will and the answers come. These verses, what they do is, as Peter is talking to us in conversation, he says, look, here's the contrast. Here's where unbelievers are, and they'll always be like that. They'll always be like that, how they're seeing Christ, but not us. The chief priests and the Pharisees, according to Psalm 118, that's how they did it. Look at verse 8. Now he goes to Isaiah chapter 8, verse 14. And a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, literally non-persuadable. That's sad. That's sad. When somebody says, it's not that I can't believe what you say, I won't believe it. I won't believe it. I hope and pray we don't have that attitude. You know, when we come in to hear preaching, all right, Lord, I'm trusting you as Savior, but when it comes to, you know, going after the mountain, I'm non-persuadable. I'm just not going to see it. I hope and pray that doesn't happen. Whereunto they were also disappointed. It's interesting here. The Lord had said in Matthew 5:18, I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And so you've got the Catholic Church saying, surely, you know, the Lord is building the church on Peter. No, Peter just proved that it's on Christ from what he just said. It's not on Peter. It's on the Lord. So, having said that, what Peter has done is he's given us a focus. All right. What we do is we see our daily lives understanding what the Old Testament said about Christ and what he is to us. Unto us that believe, he is what? Precious. But those that were disobedient, non-persuadable, hey, you failed the test. So he says, to you, he's precious. So this is what we do. Because we're in Christ, Peter says, I want to give you two things. I want to show you who you are, and I want to show you what you do because of who you are. Very simple. For instance, look at verse 5. Who you are, ye also as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood. By the way, the lively stone, living stones, same word that he used for Christ. We are the same thing. He is our life. Our purpose is to be a holy priesthood, needing no other mediator than Christ to come to God. He says, all right, this is who you are. You are the lively stones built upon the spiritual house. You're a holy priesthood. Now, this is what you do. To offer up, look at verse 5, to offer up, just like the Old Testament priest, to offer up spiritual sacrifices. They did the animal sacrifice. Now we do the spiritual sacrifice. Stop and think about that. You wake up tomorrow. What can I give to the Lord in my life? You know, think about it. Again, I've just been thinking about this because my mind can race. I don't know about you, but if I let my mind go, I can go like thunder. I can go pedal to the metal and worry about something. Anybody else like that? Hello? I can do it. I need to just go, wait a minute. Lord, I'm going to trust you. Here's what I can do. I can be faithful. If I get an opportunity to serve you, Lord, I'll do it. If I get an opportunity to say no to sin, I'll do that. I want to keep you front and center. Why? Because I am part of a royal priesthood, and you are too. And this is what we can do. When we get up tomorrow morning, even before we finish this day, we can offer up a spiritual sacrifice. Acceptable. The word acceptable means to receive to oneself with pleasure. The Lord says, yeah, you are faithful. I'm going to bless you for that. You're faithful. Acceptable to God by Jesus Christ, because it comes through him, because he lives in us. We can't do it in the flesh. Whatever we do in that way, we do it through Christ. So here we are, we offer up. You know what you could do right now, in fact? I'll tell you what you could do right now. You could offer up a sacrifice of your time by giving your attention to the Word of God right now. Notice, I did not say give your attention to me. What you need is right there in your lap. And you can see, this is who I am. This is what I do. Why do I do what I do? Because this is who I am. You know, on holy priesthood, that's amazing. He builds us to work together in him. I like this. Read this a long time ago at a meeting of the American Psychological Association. So instantly we can trust them, anything they say. Jack Lipton, a psychologist at Union College, and R. Scott Bilone, a graduate student at Columbia University, presented their findings on how members of the various sections of 11 major symphony orchestras perceive each other. For instance, the percussionists were viewed as insensitive, unintelligent, and hard of hearing, yet fun-loving. The string players were seen as arrogant, stuffy, and unathletic. The orchestra members overwhelmingly chose loud as the primary objective to describe the brass players. We have any brass players in here? Okay, you're loud. Woodwind players seem to be held in the highest esteem, described as quiet and meticulous, though a bit egotistical. And so the question came up, how in the world do these people work together? The answer, they said, was simple. Regardless of how those musicians view each other, they subordinate their feelings and biases to the leadership of the conductor. Now think of that. Who is our chief shepherd? You know, we're going to come in here and we might be different. We might have different talents. But the fact of the matter is, when the Lord puts a local fellowship together, He gives the power for people to work together. We can pray together. We can encourage each other. And when it comes to the particular things that are needed, God can raise somebody up. Think about that. We're not an orchestra, but we act like one. We're a local church. And we can work together. Amen? When Satan wants to destroy a church, what does he do? He brings in disunity, discord. Yeah, same thing. Which brings disunity. And all of a sudden, one person is pitted against another. And as the scripture says, my brethren, these things ought not so to be. So the writer to Hebrews encourages us. By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. That is the fruit of our lips giving thanks to his name. That is one thing that'll help people stay together, giving thanks to the one that saved them. Not only do we do this, we look up. We also look around. Look at verse 9. Once again, who you are. But ye, by the way, that's in the emphatic. But as for you, can you imagine, Peter, this is what he's saying. Now listen, I want you to hear this carefully. You know, we're having a conversation with him. Maybe we're gathered around the boat down there at the Sea of Galilee. He's looking at us and he's saying, you know, hey, listen, but as for you, this is what you are. This is who you are. I'm trying to tell you this. And remember, this is a man that learned so much, and he started so coarse and so crude, but listen to what God did with him. But ye are a chosen generation, a race, a body with a common life and descent. That's what that means. That means we're made of the same stuff that believers throughout the ages were made of. We have the same Savior. We read of men and women in time past, and we think, wow, you know, there was something really special. No, they put their robes on one leg at a time like we do. They have the same Spirit. They have the same Christ. So he says, look, you are of the same stuff that ever since Christ died for us, rose again, sent the Holy Spirit. Same thing, chosen by the Lord. That's a blessing. Then, next, a royal priesthood. That word royal is Greek for the word king. We are king/priest with Christ. That was the same thing, by the way, as Melchizedek was. Think about it. Now, some people see that as a burden. Folks, that's not a burden. Think of what David wrote in Psalm 84, if he wrote it. Maybe it was Asaph. In Psalm 84, he said, for a day in thy courts is better than 1,000. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. When you hear that kind of talk from people that were so close to the Lord, you got to think this, they knew something I don't. I want to learn it. I want to know it. Not only are we a chosen generation, this is who we are, again, who we are, not only a royal priesthood, but he also says, an holy nation. A nation is a multitude of the same, of people of the same nature. We are holy, separated to service for God. Not called to live as close to the world as possible, but as close to the Lord as possible. The world is looking for us to be different. So we don't act different just to be odd. If we live according to Christ, we will be different. There's something different about you. That's what they'll think. How many of you have ever had somebody say that about you? There's something different about you. Praise God. That's not you. That's him. That's him. Not only an holy nation, but also a peculiar people. This is who we are. It speaks of the unique, private, personal ownership of the saints by God. I got news for you. You don't have the pink slip to your life, and I don't have the pink slip to mine, and I'm so glad I don't. I'm so glad I'm bought with a price. I'm so glad somebody loved me enough that they would buy me. That's who you are. What we just read, that's who you are. That's Peter talking. The guy that did all that crazy stuff, that, yes, praise God, got out of the boat and then sank. That denied Christ. Oh, how much he's learned. He says, now look, this is what you do. That ye should show forth the praises of him. Think about this. You should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. We're made creatures of light by his Spirit, by salvation. Sadly, too many Christians are seeing what they can get away with and still keep their testimony intact. That's wrong, isn't it? That's wrong. Let's just call it what it is. That's sin. With a salvation we say we possess, we ought to be thinking what we can do for God, what we can do for him. Now think about this. Peter's gotten us to look up and take note of the Lord. Now we look around. Now this is what we've got to do. We've got to stop and meditate, and we need to look to ourselves. Okay, I'm going to put myself in a chair, and I'm going to remind myself, number one, again, verse 10, who you are, who I am, which in time past, he says, all right, now I'm bringing it right home to you. I'm bringing it down so you can understand this, which in time past were not a people. There was a time that you and I didn't have anything in common, but now we do. But now are the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Now watch, that's who you are. This is what you do. Verse 11, dearly beloved, I beseech you, I beg of you, as strangers, okay, sojourners, aliens in this world, which we are, we sing the song, this world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. As strangers and pilgrims, literally people that have settled down next to pagans. Dearly beloved, I beseech you, as strangers and pilgrims, just like Abraham in Hebrews, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. Abraham learned the hard way. Others learned the hard way. We don't need to learn the hard way. Abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul. There are people out there right now that are screaming more than ever. If you really want to be a help, you need to be involved with us in such and such a thing, but the problem is it's on a fleshly level. I don't need to do that to have a good impact on this nation. My greatest impact is at the throne of grace, and next, when I'm out there in the life of Christ. I want to stay away from the things that war, that battle. Every time you see an advertisement, they're trying to tell you this candy bar is better, this car is better to drive, and oh, by the way, if you buy this food, you'll forget about this other kind of food. How many of you get hung up on food sometimes? Ice cream. Oh, boy. How many of you like ice cream? Okay, praise God. We're going to go ahead and pray right now. We're going to have a fellowship next door. Somebody has a sign. No, I'm just kidding. But there are things that war against the soul. Ice cream might war against the waistline. But there are some things they war against the soul. They have said now that, especially with kids, that screen time can almost be like heroin. And it's what they're watching. That's the challenge. Look at verse 12. This is what we do. Having your conversation honest among the Gentiles, your manner of life, and outer goodness that strikes the eye. That's what that word honest means. An outer goodness that strikes the eye. Our life is honest when we live according to what we are inside. That, and this is important, that whereas they speak against you as evildoers. Now follow me on this. The world will criticize a separated Christian. But watch. They may by your good works, which they shall behold, glorify God in the day of visitation. But God uses these separated lives, you and I, as tools to bring lost souls to conviction. You've got something I want, they say. Those who are saved will glorify God because of that life that was separated. The problem. Too many Christians forgetting what they're here for and instead feeding at the trough of the world's lust. You know, the Lord told us, and we read it. You read it in the Sermon on the Mount. Be holy, for I am holy. The media has gotten so bad, it's not worth bringing up. It's so sad when you see things. But maybe some people still have this problem. Do you remember that little book that people used to get called TV Guide? Many, many years ago, somebody wrote this, and we might call it something else now. Maybe it's listed on the screen. The Bible and the TV Guide. One is well-worn but cherished with pride, not the Bible, but the TV Guide. One is used daily to help folks decide, no, not the Bible, it's the TV Guide. As pages are turned, what shall we see? Oh, what does it matter? Turn on the TV. Then the confusion reigns, they can't all agree on what they shall watch on the old TV. So they open the book in which they confide, no, not the Bible, it's the TV Guide. The Word of God is seldom read, maybe a verse ere they fall into bed, exhausted and sleepy and tired as can be, not from reading the Bible, but from watching TV. So then back to the table, side by side, is the Holy Bible and the TV Guide. I have one more thing I'd like to give you. Couple of more things. Spurgeon said this, and think about this thing, who we are and what we do. The course of rebellion against God may be very gradual, but it increases in rapidity as you progress in it. And if you begin to run down the hill, the ever-increasing impetus will send you down faster and faster to destruction. You Christians ought to watch against the beginning of worldly conformity. I do believe that the growth of worldliness is like strife, which is as the letting out of water. Once you begin, there is no knowing where it will stop. I sometimes get this question put to me concerning certain worldly amusements. May I do so-and-so? Very sorry whenever anyone asks me that question, because it shows that there's something wrong, or it would not be raised at all. If a person's conscience lets him say, well, I can do A, he will very soon go on to B, C, D, E, and through all the letters of the alphabet. When Satan cannot catch us with a big sin, he'll try it with a little one. It does not matter to him as long as he catches his fish, what bait he uses. Beware of the beginning of evil, for many who bade fair to go right have turned aside and perished amongst the dark mountains in the wide field of sin. Spurgeon just had this way of putting it. There was a book that came out one time, The Day America Told the Truth. This was interesting. When you think about some of the things that we think of, little things, like for instance, what we call a white lie, 91% of Americans lie regularly. 91%. We lie to get power, to get control. 2 out of 3 of us, speaking of Americans, believe there's nothing wrong with lying. And sadly, according to Barna, Gallup, Roper, there is no significant difference between Christians and the nation at large. So this is what we do. We stop and we say, okay, this is who I am, and my life is built around Christ. Therefore, this is what I do. This is who I am. This is what I do. And let's stand. Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray that we brought a spiritual sacrifice of attention to your word. And Lord, now I pray that you would go with us, and may we bring you a spiritual sacrifice of obedience, of understanding who we are, what our calling is, and how we can glorify you just as soon as we wake up in the morning, even tonight, really. But I pray this week we will bring you that sacrifice of a life separated. I pray this in our Savior's name. Amen.